the participants who have been connected with us shortly, we were just apprised that when Beyond Law CLC started off these webinar series, it was more, we can say, under the tutelage of Justice Bhalla, we started off, or we can say that we actually kicked off all this Beyond Law CLC, wherein the speakers as well as the participants have gone not only pan-India, but beyond that. And as Justice Bhalla at the time of formation of the name Beyond Law CLC said, that you should take Chatra the things beyond the law, and for that we have also taken certain talks which are on the soft skills and honing on the other professional skills. But since the topic for today is such that we all, Justice Bhalla and we all believed that we should have a topic which also, not only as a student of law, lawyers, and as a common man, should understand, because we all say that one should make a will, but what are the way forward for the will? And we always say that it's a common saying that where there is a will, there are relatives, and where there is a will, there is a way also. So way, let's see how it has to be. And today, and the participants who are watching us, we would just apprise that we will be having 3-part series on every Sunday with Justice Bhalla, taking the final nuances from the Indian Succession Act. The first part today will be on the will, execution, and proof. The modality for the today's webinar would be that certain issues will be also dealt upon, wherein a common man can also understand, because there are certain nitty-gritties involved with that, not as such for a lawyer, but even for the person who makes the will. But what are the phase forward? Without taking much time, I would request Justice Bhalla to take things forward. And under his aegis, we are about to touch 300 webinars also. Thank you, sir, for guiding us through.
Thank you, Vikas, for allowing me to inflict myself once again on you and everybody else. And I can also see lots of friends. I can see former Chief Justice Ajay Mittal also there on his son's iPad. I thought he'd
I also just know, right?
So, welcome to the world of webinars and legal webinars particularly. Sometime back, we had all started suffering from webinar fatigue. So, almost 6 months, I gave up this. And then I thought, no, now let's start something in the new year and not leave it at that. So, this is the first of a 3 series, as Mr. Chatrat said, a series of 3 webinars on the Indian Succession Act. Because you cannot in one just start, decide, or speak on the will, then the probate, letters of administration, and then succession certificates. Now, why this is important is this is something that touches on everybody's life. And execution of a will, we've all got to execute it one day or the other. And like Mr. Chatrat said, that where there's a will, there are relatives. But I'll add one more line, which I added on one of our groups. And one of my members from one of my groups is sitting here, that where there's a will, there's a litigation also. So for lawyers, if you execute a will, there's likely to be a probate, there's likely to be a succession certificate. And if not anything else, then there's likely to be a suit also. So taking off from this point, on this positive note for lawyers and a little negative note for people who will execute their wills, the Indian Succession Act, is of the British era, came into force in 1925. And I hope I'll not be too legal in this matter, because my intention is that people should understand how to execute a will, why a will, and what happens afterwards. So a will is actually defined under the Act itself in Section 2H. And before I say that, the law under this does not apply to Muslims, and it is no longer applies to Christians also. It only applies to Hindus, Jains, Sikhs, and others are all excluded. They have their own personal laws for making wills. So if you want to execute a will, you will have to execute it under this Act. Now, Section 2H defines a will to mean a document executed by a person to determine the course of succession to his estate or properties after his death. So it's apparent it's executed before his death. We can't possibly, there's no point saying you can't, nobody can execute anything after his death, and nobody has so far executed anything. But then this is a document that speaks from the grave. That's what it's called normally. that is speaks from the grave, and therefore there is a degree of respect attached to a will. And it's not like an ordinary sale deed or an agreement. It's something which even the person who executes it cannot come forward to vouch for its authenticity or its correctness. So you have a situation where somebody decides that this is the way and this is the manner in which my will, my property will be bequeathed by my relatives. And more often than not, we've seen that even a will doesn't satisfy relatives or children, or even maybe between the children and the wife, or the wife and the children, or the brothers, etc. So all the more important to ensure that the will you execute is executed in a manner that if it goes to a court of law, your last words, which are read only after you die, are affirmed by a court of law, and no court of law is able to say that you did not know what you were doing, or that there was a fraud, or that it was on, I mean, anything that a court can do, as we'll slowly, I'll unveil the entire gamut of this law. Now, wills are of two types, actually. I'll go straight to that. And then towards the end, I'll do a FAQ session also regarding wills. I'll answer most questions, but if some are left out, you're please welcome to ask or even put it into the chat box. Wills are of two types. They are privileged and unprivileged will. A privileged will is a will that's executed by an army person, an airman, or somebody in the Navy, especially during the times of war or an emergency, etc. So it's in section 66, and actually it's a very strange sort of a will. I'll just briefly just read out that little thing so that everybody is clear that there are two types of wills and how is it executed. I'll just give me a minute. I'll just read it out. See, it says any soldier, I'm leaving that out. Now, how is it executed? It's section 66. If there's anybody in the army over here or somebody who's been in the army, they would know how it is done. The will may be written wholly by the testator with his own hand. Such case, it need not be signed or attested. Now, if he's in the army, the Navy, or the Air Force, and there's an emergency or a war going on, if he writes it himself, and it is not signed or attested, it will be deemed to be a valid will. Since there are people from the army here, so it's now if it will be written wholly or in part by another person and signed by the testator, in such case, it need not be attested also. Even that will is valid. And it's only the only point where it is invalid is if it is not being completed by the testator, or he dies before that, or he's not traceable after that. So for the armed forces, there's a special will, which is called a privileged will. But there are very few that come to courts which are privileged wills, because probably by the time people retire, they change these wills. And the will that is executed by you and me is called an unprivileged will. And the section that applies to that is, we have a complete mode and method of execution of unprivileged wills under this act. And may I just, actually we should have shared this. So I'll just read out. It's the section is section 63, but I'm not going to delve too much on the sections because I would like everybody to understand what it is. Every testator, the word is testator. Now the person who executes the will is called the testator. The question arises, who can execute a will? Is it any person? Is it any man, any woman, anybody? The law makes no distinction between man, woman.
So if you want, I can ask JV to do the screen sharing. I've just seen JV Chandel has logged in. If you want that particular section to be done
with him right now, but anyway, let's continue.
Right.
So any person who is a major and of sound mind can execute a will. There is no prohibition on a woman or a man, and now we also have a third gender, executing a will. So the law does not recognize any restriction on the right of a person to execute a will, except that you should be a major and of sound disposing mind. Now, all these things come into court at a later stage. Now, once you have the right to execute the will, obviously you must own some property. Now, in the case of a will, there is no distinction between the property that you can dispose of, can be movable, can be immovable, and it can also be property which you have still not acquired. You may also add a clause in your will, property that I may acquire till I am alive. So it's not as if it, property which you acquire after execution of the will cannot go by way of this bequest. So the testator, that is the person who executes the will, has this complete authority to decide the mode and manner in which he may execute his will. It's up to him to what to give to his children, what to give to his wife, what to give to any other relative, any person. He can send it to charity, he can give it anywhere, and all you're left with is you will have to challenge it in a court of law. As long as the will is valid and legal, all his property will devolve in accordance with the will. Now, the issue that arises is, how do you execute a will? Can you just take an ordinary piece of paper? Can you just write whatever you feel like? What is the manner in which it is to be written? Can I write my will myself? Do I need to go to a court? Do I need to go to the Tahsildar's office? Do I need to get it registered? There are so many questions that arise. So one by one, I'll just unravel these and then come to how to execute a will. The law does not prescribe any particular format for a will. It does not prescribe any particular paper for a will. It does not prescribe any restriction on your right to make a will in any manner that you deem appropriate. All that it requires is that your intent, that your property shall devolve in a particular way, must be very clear on the document you are executing. It can be an ordinary paper. You can pick up an ordinary paper. It can be a bond paper. It can be you can also go, if you want to, you can go and purchase a stamp paper. But there is nothing prescribed in the law as to the type of paper. But as a matter of caution, it's always good to get a good quality paper if you're writing it yourself. And if you are going to purchase a paper from a stamp vendor, because papers in our country are sold by people called stamp vendors who sit outside the government offices, registrar's offices, estate offices, etc. In that situation, if you're going to purchase that sort of a paper, so please ensure that he has a register. In that register, it is mentioned, purchased for the purpose of executing a will by person so-and-so. And if you want to make it even better and you are capable of doing that, please put your signatures in that also and take the entry number. Lots of people do not do that. And then later on, when the will comes to court, then they are left to summon those people, and the other person naturally extracts a lot of money when he knows there's a dispute going on. So do this beforehand. I'm also trying to give you little cautionary principles. So you don't need any particular form of paper, but now comes another serious matter, a question which is asked very often. Does it require registration? No. No law in the country prescribes that a will is compulsorily registrable. The word is compulsorily. It's your option. You may not. Both wills have equal sanctity, but a registered will is placed on a slightly higher pedestal, though in a court of law, a judge or a lawyer will not say that. Why? Because a will is a will, and it must be respected if it is proved. Why? Because you have the registrar there, you have the photograph there, you have the photograph of the attesting witnesses there. So all those formalities are completed. So it adds a little more sanctity to the will. Though registered wills are also set aside, and unregistered wills are also set aside. Both are affirmed and both are set aside. Those are circumstances which come later as to how they are set aside, how they are affirmed. Why is, if I made a will and it is registered, how can a registered document be set aside in a court of law? That I'll explain slowly. So there is no compulsory registration, no method of applying of what paper you want, what paper you don't want. Now, the next question that arises is that if I'm writing it myself, such a will is called a holograph will. Nowadays, nobody writes it, but in olden times, lots of people used to write their own wills because of difficulty of accessing typewriters or computers or printers. There was no such things. They were either typewriters or you wrote in hand or there was a scribe. But even today, many people go to the Tehsil complex or the district complex or whatever is available in your city to get a will executed. And even the most educated of people at times even go there and get them scribed also from those people sitting there. You must have seen that in lots of places, sitting outside the registrar's complex, sitting there. So you go there, they'll scribe it for you. There is no necessity. It's not legal that you get it scribed from a scribe who's authorized by the government. But yes, if you do get it scribed, then please ensure he also has a register. He has a register which is issued to him by the government. In that register, you must ensure that the entry is made, that will scribed at the behest of so-and-so, and he must sign in it. And if possible, you can also sign in it. So that tomorrow there's evidence, this chain of evidence continues. And everybody knows who scribed the will. And please get the will attested at the bottom. Get him to sign also. It's very rarely that you come across a will where the scribe's name is written. But I've seen many now coming where lawyers are drafting them. So it's written, drafted on the instructions of my client. So-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. So these are some very important things which lead to eventually wills being set aside by courts. Now a will, there's another little thing I'd like to say right here. The person who attests it, the person who executes the will, that's the testator, is not, like I told you, there's no particular format, but he must give his full name. He must give his parentage. He must give his permanent address and his present address also. There are many people who, when they reach a particular age, are no longer living at their permanent address. They go and live with their children or they go and live somewhere else. And soon you'll have a case where people will be living in old age homes. They are becoming more popular by the day. So you will probably be executing wills, people in old age homes at various places, which are maybe not their normal place of residence. So these things have to be taken into account. But unfortunately, and there's another very significant failure this time of the governments actually. During COVID, they did not make an arrangement for people to execute their wills online. People were still asked to come to the registrar's office to execute wills online, though in America and in various places, they've allowed execution of wills even online by recording their statements through a video conference of the attesting witnesses and the. So this is something which is also going to come tomorrow, that you'll be allowed to execute wills online. And of course, now we have the concept of a living will also coming in, where even during your lifetime is not part of this discussion, but someday we can have a little listing on what is a living will and how does it affect people, because it's the people who, all of us who are getting older and all, may have to come across this situation and may have to do something like that. Now coming to the execution of the will, and I'll take the other things later. will, as I told you, is executed under Section 63. Now, how is it executed? The person who wants to execute the will, that's who's called the testator, he affixes his, after the entire thing has been typed out or he's written the whole thing, he affixes his signature or his mark. The word used in the section, in Section 63A, is his mark. Now, this mark is actually means at one time, we had a lot of people who were illiterate. So they fixed their thumb impressions. Now, in the case of a left thumb impression is fixed by a man and a right thumb impression is fixed by a woman. So the ladies are right-handed, men are left-handed. Actually, I somehow never understood this logic, but that's how the law operates. That men are leftists and ladies are rightists. So we have this constant debate in this country of left and right. So ladies can, if they want to be, if they feel they are from the right, then men are from the left. So it's the left thumb and the right thumb. So if he is wants to, and there will be even situations where a person is not capable of fixing his thumb impression, but he has his senses, he can't sign. There are lots of people who suffer from Alzheimer's. There are people who cannot sign. They are in hospital. So what do? They affix their mark. That is their thumb impression. So it is not just that if you are illiterate, but if you are unwell, so unwell that you have your senses about you, but you want to execute a will. So how do you do it? So then you put your thumb impression. A man puts the left one, a lady puts the right one. Or there is another provision. He can ask somebody else also to sign on his behalf, but under his direction, in which case whoever is there helping him out to execute the will must make an endorsement to that effect, that this signature has been affixed by person A on behalf of person B under his instructions and in his presence. So see, all sorts of eventualities have been looked at. Now, suppose there's a person who can't even put his thumb impression. In that situation, he can ask person B or C or D, you do it on my behalf, and then a note will be made there. And how that is done, I'll explain it later, because you have a set of attesting witnesses. Now, witnesses who come in, there is a requirement of two or more, not less than two. There must be two people who will attest the will. Now, these two people must necessarily have some knowledge about the person, the testator. But what happens in a large number of wills is everybody goes down to the estate office in Chandigarh. I'm speaking from Chandigarh, or to the registrar or the tahsildar or wherever. And whoever they engage to do it, he provides them with witnesses or one witness. You will notice in many wills, there'll be a scribble written there, not even his full name sometimes. So there are a lot of professional witnesses available to you at these tahsil premises. But a small advice to you is please do not avail their services, because when it comes to court, then again, you can be subject to any sort of blackmail by anybody. The man may just refuse to come to court. And then what will you do? How will you prove it? You won't even know who it is, because he's again, it's the scribe who will provide you all these witnesses. So take your witnesses with you. And a small little caution, another note of caution, ensure that the witness is much younger than you, so that he survives by the time your will comes to court, if it comes to court. Never take a person who's older than you, so that by the time your will comes to court for being examined, both your witnesses are dead and then you have another problem. Though the law also gives you another problem, how to solve that also. So it's not a situation as if don't make any old person a witness, but try and get younger people. And also ensure that they are not the beneficiaries of your will. If a witness is a beneficiary of a will, a question is automatically raised in court that he prevailed over the old man or the old woman, and he prevailed over this person's because they were in a frail state of mind, or they were unwell, or not able to so and so. So ensure that your witness is not a beneficiary. And a beneficiary generally should not take part in the execution of the will. Though on facts, I think everybody knows that it's always the beneficiary who takes the old man or the old lady or the person to get the will executed. But if he is apparently involved in the whole thing, then the will can be in jeopardy, and it can always be a doubt can be created as to its execution. So now comes the part of the witness. I can just read that to you, and then you can have your little questions also. It says, B, the signature or mark of the testator or the signature of the person signing for him shall be so placed that it shall appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the writing as a will. Now, this is what the testator has done. And how does he do it? When does he do it? Where does he do it? It comes to subsection C. It says the will shall be attested by two or more witnesses. You can have more than two. I had a matter where there were seven witnesses. So I asked the question, why seven? They said we wanted to make it firmer, and eventually it got set aside actually. So it's not, the number doesn't matter, it's the quality that matters of the will. So sometimes people feel, okay, let's have more witnesses, you know, then everybody, the court will say, oh, so many people came to say that you were doing the right thing. But it's not that, it's the quality of the will, the nature of the will. So the will shall be attested by two or more witnesses, each of whom has seen the testator sign or affix his mark to the will. He has seen him, each of whom has seen him or has seen some other person sign the will in the presence and by the direction of the testator, or who has received from the testator a personal acknowledgement of his signature or mark or of the signature of such person. So what does it say? That the attesting witness must have seen the testator affixing his signature or his mark, or if he's authorized somebody else, that somebody else, or he must receive an acknowledgement from the testator that, yes, I signed it. This has to be very clearly understood, because lots of arguments take place in courts on this. They're not signed. So this is the method exactly provided. And if you'll see a will, the last para of a will invariably has this sentence written, that the witnesses have signed in the presence of so-and-so and have seen so-and-so affixing is some impression, depending on if it's a mark, some impression, etc. This para is absolutely imperative that you incorporate in your will. If you don't do this, the will is in trouble, is in serious jeopardy. And there's another part of it. But do both of them have to see each other signing also? There are two attesting witnesses. No. The next part of the section says that, I can just read it, but it shall not be necessary that more than one witness be present at the same time. And no particular form of attestation shall be necessary. So I think probably this is one of the most easiest documents to execute, but I think one of the documents that gets set aside in court also, though it may be so easy, maybe it's because it's so easy that it gets set aside also. So a will requires two attesting witnesses who may have seen him signing, received an acknowledgement from him that it's my signature, or the mark has been put in my, but they need not be present together. There was a big dispute in courts also for a long time on this, that whether they have to be together or they have to be separate. If they are separate, in what manner are they separate? So I'm not taking you all to that dispute and how it was resolved and what it was done, because this is a topic that concerns lawyers more than it concerns lay people. And lawyers, there are huge amount of judgments on both sides, and generally it's eventually how it has been executed that would be important. Now, a small little advice, again, a very practical sort of thing from whatever experience I have as a lawyer, and all those who are here as lawyers who understand what I'm saying. When a will is scribed by you, whether in your handwriting or is typed by you, please ensure that the spacing between the sentences is consistent up to your signatures. If there is, suppose it is one millimeter between, or 1 centimeter between each sentence, it should remain right till the end. Otherwise, you'll be accused that this signature was on an empty piece of paper and you typed this entire thing much later and this was adjusted. And this has happened. We've all seen wills like that, where suddenly there's a spacing where it's very narrow, then it becomes wider, then it becomes narrower, then at the end again there'll be about 2 inches. I mean, people just don't seem to understand what they're doing. So those will raise a doubt instantly, those sort of things. And please put your signatures, the testator must put his signatures, generally they come at the right hand side, bottom right hand side where it ends generally. But there is no such thing, because there's no attestation required. There's nothing required of a will. There's no affidavit for a will. We don't have a verification for a will. So you can put it anywhere you feel like, but like it's written in the act, that signature of yours must indicate to anybody who's looking at it that this document was intended to be a will. And another little advice, please avoid any words which may tend to be interpreted in 2 ways or 3 ways. We all have a habit as we grow up in life of trying to, with due respect to everybody here, trying to confuse issues instead of trying to make them simple. So make a very, very simple, straight will. This is my property. This property will go to person A. This will go to person B. This will go to person C. And if you are not giving anything to person D, E, F, this is the most important part. You must write, give a reason. However small the reason may be, however perfunctory the reason may be, but you must give a reason why you're depriving a particular child or a particular class, preferably class one heirs. That means children, wife, daughters, etc. Why are you depriving them? You must give a reason in that will. If you don't give a reason, the court immediately thinks that this has been done at the behest of the beneficiary, and the person who has made the will was actually totally not aware of what he was doing. So a reason to deprive a particular heir of property must be incorporated. I am not to be misunderstood to say that you can't make a will, you can't deprive somebody of any property. A will is always meant to change the course of natural succession. The primary reason for a will is to alter the course of succession, but many of us maintain that succession also. So if you want to alter the course of natural succession, please give a reason as to why you are depriving class one heir, class two heir. I'll make it easier by saying particular child or particular daughter or particular son. Why? That is a very, very important thing, and that leads to a lot of arguments in court that look, the very fact that the old man or the old lady did not write why she's giving, depriving so and so, shows that she was not fully aware, she was not fully up there, she was not fully. So these are things, small things which we have to consider. Now, having said these 2 things, now when a will comes to court, I'll keep on taking this through the legal part also and giving you small, how do you prove a will? Now, in a court, the will comes to a court in a probate, in a letters of administration, or in a suit. That we'll be dealing with next Sunday, so I'm not taking you to the probate and et cetera, et cetera. But whenever the will is called into question, it is the person who says that I have inherited under the will who has to prove the will. So the propounder of the will has to prove to the court not only that it was executed in the manner in which the will appears, meaning thereby he has to prove that the testator was of sound disposing mind, was aware of what he was doing, meaning thereby, and that this signature, if the signature is doubted, that these are the signatures of the person who has executed the will. What we normally see in courts, and even as lawyers, is one party files a suit saying, I am the son and I am owner of this extent. The other party takes out a will. And then this person will say that this will is forged and fabricated. So the onus is on him to prove that. That it's a very tenuous onus which falls to the parties. The party who has come to court claiming other than the will can sit tight and say, okay, go and prove your will. So he has to examine the attesting witnesses. He has to examine, if possible, the signatures. You have experts, etc., coming in, the thumb impressions. And that goes into the Evidence Act. That is section. I can just take you to the Evidence Act. But before that, I told you that a will need not be registered. But the heirs can get the will registered after the death under section 40 of the Registration Act. There is a provision for post-death registration. It's called a post-mortem registration under section 40 of the Registration Act. So an unregistered will, there's a complete procedure prescribed, can also be registered after the death of the person. So it's not as if the law is not aware of these problems. So now coming to how to prove a will, I'll just take you to section 68 is where you prove of execution of document required by law to be attested. A will is not an ordinary document. So it is not proved in an ordinary way. A normal document is proved by the person who has executed the document, stepping into the witness box and saying, yes, this is my signature. I executed it. But here the person is dead. So he cannot obviously step into the witness box. He cannot be asked to come and say, this is my signature, I executed it. So the person who executes it has to go through this process and ensure that one attesting witness at least is called for the purpose of proving its execution. One is the minimum. You can get both of them if you so like. But the dispute arises, this is the easiest part. The dispute arises if neither of them is available or both of them are dead. There's a situation, how will you prove it? So the law does have section 69, which allows you to prove if a person is not available or he's dead. So this is the entire matter is provided under the Evidence Act, section 69. If no such attesting witness can be found, or if the document was to have been executed, we can leave this. It must be proved that the attestation of one attesting witness at least is in his handwriting, and that the signature of the person executing the document is in the handwriting of that person. So how will you prove his handwriting? You will get his son, you will get his wife, and sometimes you'll even get people who worked with him, who know his handwriting, know his signatures. And then also you will find out other handwritings and other signatures, other documents. And then an expert will come into the court. He'll compare the handwritings. and he'll submit a report and he'll come also. Similarly with the signatures of the testator also. So the law provides for almost every manner in which to prove the will. And even if the person comes to court and denies the execution, suppose there's an attesting witness who is won over by the other party and he does not prove the will and he comes and denies it, then the section 71, if the attesting witness denies or does not recollect the execution of a document, its execution may be proved by other evidence, sorry. So now it's up to the lawyer to find out that evidence, how to prove, get that evidence. So that is there. It's not as if he denies it, it'll be thrown away. Unfortunately, in our courts of law, we have this situation where lots of false depositions take place and many people come and deny their own signatures also at times. And this is seen very, very often in wills also and in many other litigations that the person just says, no, I have not signed it. And he never gives any reason or doesn't come forward. But this happens very often. So if the law protects you in every way, it grants you a method how to prove these documents. So what I am suggesting is, the system where you take a photograph on registration, the best option to use is to get it registered. And we have also been suggesting, I did send a small paper to the government, that why can't we start recording the execution of wills? And why, if we are taking photographs while registration, why can't we make a system where you record the execution of a will by a person and record the entire any instrument you have, which you can then certify under the IT Act to be a correct reproduction of what happened at that stage. So these are things which need to be looked at. And as society is progressing, we are going from a paper to a paperless courts. We are going from paper to paperless society. I think time has come to now even allow all this, though no rules and regulations have been issued. We didn't even have this during COVID, like I said. So I saw at the bottom one question, somebody had put up a question regarding testator of a will, say a widow disposing of the property of her husband along with the property in her name, witnessed by her own sons, beneficiaries witnessed by the daughter-in-law. This some gentleman has put up this question. I'll just answer this. We are right now dealing with the validity of a will. Now there are some other questions which I have in fact made about frequently asked questions regarding execution of a will. I've answered who can make a will, what property can be willed. Any property that is owned by a person can be willed. I've said movable and immovable, as well as property that will be acquired in the future. But there is one property which I cannot will, and that is property which is beyond my share in an HUF or in a copartnery. So that is dealt with separately. There's a power under the Hindu Succession Act. To the extent of my shareholding, I can make it. It cannot apply beyond that. But unfortunately, lots of people just make a will regarding property without realizing that this is HUF or this is copartnery property, but that's not a subject matter today. So it is normally then, if it is proved that it is ancestral property or copartnery property or property which is of an HUF, then to that extent, the will gets set aside. Because you can only make a will of a property of which you are the owner. So then there's another thing which, sorry, I missed out. I should have said so. The person I said is called a testator. The person who received the property is called the beneficiary. But there is another very important person under this act. He's called the executor of the will. a person, you may appoint a person to execute your will. He has to collect all the properties and then distribute them to the beneficiaries. So, but it is not compulsory. It is not necessary to appoint an executor. Now, even if you go in for probate, a beneficiary can also go in probate after taking the permission of the executor. But I've personally been involved as a lawyer in a case where the executor refused to file the case and we had to go to court against him. And then he filed the case. Then he filed a probate. And there are many, many hoary tales about executors. So please try and avoid giving any trouble to your children or your beneficiaries by appointing people who are not part of your estate, because sometimes things operate after you pass away, things operate in a very different way. So my advice, this is an advice, you should not appoint somebody to execute your estate. Those times have gone when you could trust anybody without asking a question. Now, there's another question that comes up. How many wills can a person execute? He can execute any number of wills. He can execute a will in the morning, in the evening, in the afternoon, at night, next year, this year, whatever he feels like. But it's the last valid will that will prevail. He can also amend the will. He can change the will. Amended will is called a codicil. There's the procedure for a codicil or amendment is the same as for execution of a will. There is no difference. And like I've said, no particular paper, no stamp paper, and a person can write his own will in his own handwriting. And then I had also told you that while purchasing a will, please take a try and get an entry main. And what happens is lots of times when will is written in hand or even the typewriter, many times things are not legible because the scribes are so used to writing in a particular manner that you give them an idea of what you're doing. But when you look at the, I mean, you will not look at it, obviously, you'll be dead by that time. But when people look at it, they wonder, is it really true that, I mean, this man who was so eminent, this is what he wrote? So lots of times when it comes to court, you get quite surprised. But then you have to look at other things. So be careful in what you're writing. And there are a lot of mistakes, spelling mistakes, word mistakes. Your name will be wrongly spelled. And all these will be taken advantage of by the side who's fighting with you. All mistakes will be taken care of. There should be no cuttings in the will, preferably no cuttings in the date, in the signatures. And preferably my advice always is to sign every page, either in the left-hand margin or at the bottom so that nobody can add any more sentences or lines. And this does happen. It has been seen. We have many from the legal world. I have the advantage of a retired Chief Justice here also, and I hope he'll agree with me on this, that we've all seen wills where things have been added, and this is nothing new. It happens all the time. Rest, I think I can leave everything for the time being. I purposely kept it. I tried to keep it as simple as possible and not take too many legal listings. But before I just leave it open to everybody to ask questions, when a will comes to court, I said the person who propounds it has to prove it. Now, what does he have to prove? Apart from proving the signatures and apart from proving sound disposing mind, he has to also dispel any suspicious circumstances that may surround the execution of the will. Now, suspicious circumstances are numerous. There may be a difference in the signatures. The dates may not tally. The properties may not tally. There may be properties included which do not belong to him. His thumb impression may be different at one place. His signatures may be different. And there's always thing. There's another thing on signatures, that as time progresses, your signatures also tend to change. And particularly people in their older ages, when they are suffering from various other diseases, and lots of people have Alzheimer's, there's a tremor comes into the hand. So all these things have to be looked at, and lawyers are ready to, you know, look at these things when a will comes to court. It's not as if any lawyer is going to spare any old man's will. He has a job to do and he's bound to do it. Now there's one very interesting question. Please deliberate on a testator intoxicated or drunken and sick. I don't know, probably this is a question by a teetotaler. Intoxicated and sick. Every person who challenges a will, and particularly when they are sons, they'll always say that the old man was a drunk old man. He never knew what he was doing. And therefore, he willed away this property to the other brother. This is very often, but it's almost impossible to prove. The question lies not in his being drunk. The question lies, was he in such a state of mind at the stage of execution of the will that he did not know what he was doing? It's not a question of drinking. See, drink, as you know, liquor provides a huge amount of money to the government. If it was so bad, the government would ban it. Correct? It's so, since it's socially acceptable to drink, so there's no question of merely because you drink or you are a drunkard. Let's presume you're a drunkard. Suppose you're an alcoholic. Suppose you're attending Alcoholic Anonymous meetings. Can you not make your will? Of course you can. What you've got to prove is that at that moment, you were so inebriated that you were unable to understand what you were doing. It's almost very difficult to prove. So this question, I just found it slightly interesting. So there's another question. If Mr. Chatrat permits me, can I keep answering them? Or would you want to? Should I keep answering, Mr. Chatrat?
Sir, one way is I can read the question so that you can concentrate on the answer. This is over, then I can take the questions.
I think more or less I am finished. There are other sections which I don't want to go through. I just, for lawyers over here who are on the legal profession or anybody, unfortunately, this act is read very, very rarely. If you go from section 74 to section 111, almost everything which you need to prove in a will or which you need to challenge in a will is recorded there. As a lawyer, honestly, I never read it. As a judge, nobody read it out to me. Very honest on that. And I'm quite sure most of you would also not have read section 74 to section 111 of the Indian Succession Act. Time to be honest, I think. It's the new year. So let's be honest in this year, whether we've actually read it or not. So I think very few people have read it. But if you'll read it, you'll be shocked and you'll realize you don't even need a single judgment from any court to challenge a will, actually, or to prove a will. The British were people who were very particular, unlike our act now, which is this new act which we had last 2-3 years ago, which has already been amended 500 times. Unlike them, the Succession Act has been amended only about 6 times. So there's an art of drafting a particular thing. So I'll now take the questions. I think we are almost, it's 5:53, it's been an hour. Yes, Mr. Chatrat, please.
I have told them because a lot of people, questions are vague. I have asked them the question should be quite concise and precise. Meanwhile, I will take the questions which can be, according to me, are very precise. This is by Abhishek Sharma. Can't we find out the registered marks of fingerprints to prove by technology and match it with the Aadhaar card, etc., in respect of fingerprints?
Actually, I've not been able to. What does he mean that we have to become Sherlock Holmes? Does he mean that we have to lift the fingerprints from the will? I can't understand that. Probably he means that.
Yes. Malvinder Gill, can an executor be a beneficiary?
Yes, there's no prohibition in law. In fact, if you read from 74 to 111, it says so specifically. But then the onus is on, the larger onus will come onto him as a beneficiary. He can, even a attesting witness can be a beneficiary. There's no prohibition. These are all cautionary principles.
So this is by Rishikesh. Though you have primarily covered it, what are the practical steps in executing a will that we need to follow after the death of a testator to be able to sell the property of a will?
Registration after death.
Oh, what are the practical steps to be taken for executing a will that we need to follow after the death of a testator to be able to sell the property?
You mean for registration? I don't. Execution of the will means what?
What are the practical steps for executing a will? Let's take things forward.
He'll be alive that time. Huh?
Yeah. So he just actually wants that you should summarize what are the basic steps which can be taken. That one are snapshot.
Okay, basic steps are you should have your brains about you. You should know what is your property. You should be of sound disposing mind. You should not be so debilitated by any disease or by any mental incapacity that you are unable to figure out what you are doing. And then you are free to execute the will in any manner you feel like. Any paper, any scribe, you can write it yourself. But the attesting witnesses are to be there. And you've got to sign in one of them in the presence of one. So obviously you cannot sign in the presence of the other if he's not there. So you must there be acknowledgement to him that yes, I signed, but in fact, this is also never done. It's always both are together invariably. And they all say, yes, we were together, but sometimes situation arises like this. That's all. Registration, you go to the registrar and there's a particular format. That's where the whole problem arises. They'll take your photograph also. They'll put everything. If they take your photograph, please ensure that your signatures are on the photograph when they take it. And God help you if you come across a lawyer and a court. So that's your...
This is by Sir Nitika Modi, difference between a succession certificate and letter of administration. That I will say that she should connect with us for 24th and 27th.
On the
24th and 31st.
Third webinar. But I can tell her a difference that in a succession certificate, there doesn't have to be a will. So we leave the suspense going now. Why?
Yeah. Geeta says, can one legal heir write will about the property that is likely to be divided in 2022?
Can legal heir? Yes. If I am likely to inherit a property, say even 5 years from today, I can put it in my will that any property that I may inherit, purchase, or maybe allotted to me at any time shall also go to so-and-so in this manner. If you don't get it, so be it. He doesn't get it. You have to be the owner on the date of your death. Remember this. All the properties you own at the time of recording of your will and death. Now, suppose I have 3 properties on the date of execution. I sell off 2. So obviously my beneficiary can't go to the person I've sold it to and say, okay, he made a will to me. So now you please give me those 2 properties back, because the will comes into effect on the date I die. And another small clarification, it doesn't come into effect on the date you get a declaration from court. It comes into effect on the date of death. It's only that it is ratified by a court. A court does not grant you succession. A court only affirms your succession on the basis of will or on the basis that you are your father's progeny or your mother's progeny, whatever it is. A court only confirms a state of fact by applying a particular law. Next, any question?
So we have unmuted Mr. Pankaj Sapro. He wants to ask a question directly.
Yeah, yeah. Please, Pankaj, carry on.
So little doubt on that witness part.
Yeah.
You said there can be 2 or more witnesses.
Yes.
And then you also said that the 2 or more witnesses need not be present at the same time.
Yes.
So that, I mean, to a layman, it sounds very vague, because then does the guy whose will is being made out, does he have to sign in front of each of those witnesses?
No, either he signs or he gives an acknowledgement of his signature to them. That I've signed this. This is my signature.
Which they keep with themselves.
No. You can write it in the will if you want. And preferably it should be written. That's what I'm insisting. Write everything. Normally, wills, this is not written. That section which I read out to you says both of them need not be present at the same time.
Yes.
They can come in later. I can sign and A sees me signing. To B, I say, look, I have signed and he has seen me signing. Unfortunately, this certificate is never written. Why? Because we all, as lawyers also and as judge, we are a little nervous of such a situation or somebody being able to prove that. So we say, no, they were all present. They saw him signing and they signed in the presence of each other.
Yes.
But the law is slightly different.
So it needs to be mentioned in the when the second...
As a matter of caution, but nobody mentions it. I at least have not seen a will where it is so mentioned.
Okay.
So we have unmuted Malvinder Mill again.
I just wanted to ask, can a person who's a foreign citizen execute a will or make a will in India and get it registered in India?
I'm not sure of that, Malvinder. I'll reply to you privately.
Okay. Sure. Very important, but I really need to know this.
I know you need to execute a will.
All right. Thank you.
I'll just check it up. I don't want to make a mistake.
Sure.
I'm entitled to make a wrong statement also, but I don't want to.
Sure. Thanks.
But I don't think there should be any impediment.
Because citizenship is from abroad, but living I am in India. So resident of India, but citizen of UK.
No, you can write a will on the wall of your house. There's no such prohibition.
I'm just validity of the will in case
question
of
is it question. Valid or is it not valid?
correct.
Vikashil Verma says whether a person can execute a will in respect of enhanced compensation of an acquired land if the same is to be decided in future.
Yes, why not? There's no prohibition. Anything that you are likely to get also you can say. You'll see all wills have a clause in it that any property that I may purchase, acquire, or maybe allotted to me in the future shall also devolve in this manner. There is always a clause. The whole question is whether those gains come to you or not come.
So this is by Advocate Modi. If first wife expires, the property after her death is transferred to her husband's name. And after the husband's death, the property is transferred in her name in Maharashtra records. Government of first wife is daughter of the first wife is alive and claims her share. Can second wife make a will to the some person?
This is too complicated for this webinar right now. She'll have to write it out to me. There are 5 people who are going around in circles because some of them will be going under the Hindu Succession Act and some will go under the will. I don't know. She's made a will. If the wife has become owner under the Hindu Succession Act, I don't know now what I'm just, in fact, I've lost track of immediately. If she can just send a mail to me, I'll try and answer the question.
Yes. So now some questions are in a piecemeal. I think we can connect with that later on. And for tomorrow's webinar, I can announce and we can proceed further.
Okay.
Yeah. Because certain questions, they have sent the mail, but the only issue is that the questions are to be interwoven. They have first question at 5:40, then thereafter 5:50, they have to be interconnected. So tomorrow's webinar would be on public accountability by Professor Nishtha Jaiswal, Vice Chancellor of Himachal Pradesh National Law University, Shimla. So do stay connected with us tomorrow at 4 p.m. And thank you, sir. And I can share this, that this is one of the webinars wherein we had the audience on the Facebook coupled with the YouTube and on this platform, very static. And I often say on this is the only good thing which one enjoys, except for the ECG where the line goes straight, you feel tensed. And I will share with you the screenshot later on. It has garnered a lot of views on the YouTube as well as on the Facebook. So everyone, stay connected with us for more insights on legal perspectives and soft skills. And also connect on 24th and 31st, where the part 2 and part 3 of the Indian Succession Act will be taken forward by Justice Bhalla. And thank you on behalf of all the participants for sharing your insights, and more so they were practical aspects. And to all those participants who have been watching us live on the Facebook and YouTube, coupled with this platform, we are all honored. And more so, we're also glad that Justice A.K. Mittal, the former Chief Justice of Madhya Pradesh, as well as Mizoram, who has joined.
And soon to be a speaker on this, one of these.
That's true. And we are glad that he has encouraged us. And Thank you, everyone. Namaskar, Jai Hind. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.